Now, the zeroth law, for some reason it was called zeroth, because first and second were already defined, people did not want to rename them, and it was thought that zeroth law is a more basic law compared to first and second. Finally, it turns out that that is not true, all three laws have to be on the same, have to have the same status. Now, the what is zeroth law? The zeroth law is a law which considers the behavior of two systems separated by a non-adiabatic partition. Partition or wall or boundary, whatever you want to say. Again, just like first law, where Karathiotori said that all adiabatic systems seem to behave in a similar way, generalize that as his statement of the first law. Here also we are going to look at something and generalize it. What we do here is the following. Let us have a system A and a system B. And let us say that the wall in between is not adiabatic. First definition, a wall which is not adiabatic or a non-adiabatic wall, we define it as a diathermic wall. So, a wall which is not adiabatic, and that means a wall or a partition or a boundary or an interface which will allow interactions other than work, that means interactions of the heat kind, is called a diathermic wall. So, just the way process was short form for a change of state, diathermic is a short form for non-adiabatic. That is it. So, diathermic wall allows Q interaction also. Now, we simplify the thing by saying, and I will simplify the diagram in a short way. For the sake of argument, let us say that A and B are constrained such that between them only heat interaction takes place. This is for simplicity of argument, and this does not distract us from or make us deviate from generality, because you know, remember that work requires some sort of a displacement, either a mechanical displacement like movement of a wall or movement of a stirrer, or an electrical displacement like movement of electrons, and this can always be suppressed by fixing the wall at a place or freezing the stirrer or putting a brake on the stirrer, or you know, opening the electric circuit and things like that. Now, what we do is, the observation is this. Remember first law, the experiment which is claimed to demonstrate the history of first law is Joule's experiment. in which he studied the behavior of a system containing some amount of water from a given initial state to a final state. And he executed different paths and he found that the energy transfer as dictated by the rising or the lowering of a weight was the same whichever path it took. That was the driving force for the first law. So here what we do is we do the following experiment. I am drawing here the state space of A. That you can write PA, VA if you feel like. And this is the state space of B. And what we do is we bring state A to some state A1, system A. And then we do the following experiment. We have our system B initially at different states, B0, B1, B2, B3, B4, whatever, Bx, By, Bz. Allow it to interact with this system A across a diathermic wall. And see whether any heat interaction takes place or does not take place. Okay. Of course, we can also observe in which direction it takes place, but our main thing is whether heat interaction takes place or not. What we find is the following. We find that there are some states in the state space of system B, let me call them B1, B2, B3, B4 and so on. These are states such that if we allow them to interact with system A when it is in state A1, refuse to have any heat interaction even when allowed to have. This is the first part of Zeroth law. Yes, Zeroth law, one part. There are states B1, B2, etc., which do not have any Q interaction with system A in state A1. So, coming back to the earlier figure, maybe I should put it here. I think, yes, good. Of course, that upper part of the figure is not seen here, but I think you have it, this one. So, what the experiment we have done is we have system A in a given state A1, and we have experimented with various states of B. Zeroth law says that, first part of Zeroth law says that you will discover a number of states in the state space of system B, at least one, if not more, which if you allow them to interact with system A when it is state A1, will refuse to have any heat interaction, in spite of being separated by a non-adiabatic boundary. And you can demonstrate it is non-adiabatic because there are other states which will merely have a heat interaction. But there will be a set of states, at least one, which will refuse to have any heat interaction. Okay. This is not a derivation, this is a statement. Okay. It is a basis of a law. Such states exist. So, this is what I call the existence part. There are states, or in mathematical, there exist states, just the way some theorem says, between there exists a value x naught such that if f of x naught is 0. Okay. So this is the existence part. Now comes the second part. Which is generally stated as the zeroth law in many textbook. Hardly any textbook mentions the first part of zeroth law, but that is a necessary. Unless you talk of the first law, you cannot talk of the first part, you cannot talk of the second part. The second part says that this property, or actually what I should do is, let us have some definitions before I come to the second part. So that the second part can be shorter. Definition. Okay. Such pairs of states are called isothermal states. That means when I say that A1 will refuse to have any interaction with B1, we will say B1 and A1 or A1 and B1 are isothermal. Similarly, A1 and B2, in which order you write is immaterial because it is a pair. Are isothermal. Isothermal pair of states and so on. Okay. And another way, this is definition A. Definition B is again just to understand our earlier terminology and put it on a common footing so that we can keep on using the earlier terminology. States A1 and B1 are in thermal equilibrium. Each other. This is nothing but another way of saying A1, B1 are isothermal states. And when are they isothermal states? When we allow them to interact with each other across a diathermic partition, they refuse to have any thermal interaction or heat interaction. Why should they refuse to have a heat interaction? Because the first part of zeroth law says that such states, pairs of states will exist. Okay. So with this, what we have done is we have looked at the situation which leads us to the idea of zeroth law of thermodynamics. No. Which one?
Huh. I find certain circular over here. How shall I understand that there is heat interaction or there is no heat interaction?
Heat interaction. Okay. If there is a heat interaction, there is some interaction. Some interaction will lead to a change of state which can be observed. Okay.
This property is other than temperature now.
Yes. We have not yet defined temperature. Yeah. Okay. But we have that first state postulate that the state of a system can always be defined using primitive variables.
Yes.
Okay. So, all that we have to do is keep on observing the primitive variables. If there is a change in any one of them, there is a change of state. And if there is a change of state, there is an interaction. And then we use the work interaction definition to determine whether it is work or heat. So, all these tools we have developed so far. So, we are not, that we have constrained for simplicity. Otherwise, the argument will become longer, but the same argument continues. This is only for simplicity. That we say that we have constraint, the wall is not moving, the wall is not electrically conducting.
We are saying that it is a isothermal condition, so we can say that some amount of heat is transferring from A to B and the same amount is transferring from B to A. We cannot say heat.
No, we are saying that we allow A1 and B1 to interact with each other. During the interaction, for simplicity, we have prevented any work interaction taking place. So, if there is a change in state of the systems, then any interaction which takes place is heat interaction. We have said that since no change in state is taking place, there will be no interaction taking place of the heat kind because work has already been suppressed. Okay. But the net heat interaction will be zero. Net heat interaction will be zero. We are looking at the gross level. So, you can always say that look, you are saying zero heat transfer, but there may be Q12 equal to minus Q21 with a negative sign, so be it. Net interaction is zero, net change of state is zero, that is what we are interested in.
Sir, here isothermal does not mean the constant temperature.
We have not yet defined what is temperature.
No, we have not defined, but isothermal leads to what does the term mean, isothermal states here?
See, we have said here, that is what I was looking at. What have we done is we have looked at the situation which leads to Zeroth law. Then we said the first statement of Zeroth law is the discovery that there exist the states B1, B2 which do not have any heat interaction with state A. This is the existence part. Then the definition is if A1 and B1 refuse to have any heat interaction across a diathermic partition, we then define them to be isothermal pair of states. Okay. And then just because we have been always talking of thermal equilibrium, we say if A1 and B1 or say A1 and B2, any pair of states is an isothermal pair of states, another way of saying they are isothermal pair of states is to say that they are in thermal equilibrium. So, here is a definition of isothermal states. That means they must have zero heat interaction across a diathermic wall. And here is a definition of two states being in thermal equilibrium with each other. That means they are isothermal states. That means there should be no heat interaction with each other. That's all. Okay. Remember that we have not yet defined even the concept of temperature, at least in this set of lectures. Okay. Now we come to the second part. Zeroth law. If the first half was existence, the second half is the transitivity property. What is a transitivity property? Transitivity property is something which at a same level. For example, in mathematics, equality is considered a transitive property because if A equals B, B equals C, then A equals C. So, you can write A equals B equals C in any order. That is known as a transitive property. There are properties which are not necessarily transitive properties. For example, A is the square root of B, B is the square root of C, does not mean A is the square root of C. There are properties which are non-transitive, there are properties which are transitive. So, let us see the transitivity property. It says, this simply says, and this is the statement all of us know as the zeroth law of thermodynamics. Okay. If A1, B1 are isothermal states and if say B1 and you take some other system C, C1 are isothermal states, then this implies that A1, C1 are also isothermal. This is the zeroth law all of us have studied in textbooks without really, without even talking of the existence. But this is the formulation of Landsberg and others, that this is the way Zeroth law is properly developed. Now, where does temperature come in? Temperature comes in as follows. Now, again, let us go back to our two systems, A and B. This is the state space of A. This is the state space of B. And if you want xA, xB, yA, yB. What we have done is we have fixed a state A1 of system A, and we have discovered a number of states. For simplicity, let me say, now thermodynamics does not say so, but let us assume that this is the states of B which are in thermal equilibrium with A1, or which can be in thermal equilibrium with A1. So, any one of the states here, if you want, you can call this B1, B2, B3. These are some properties. If you want, you are more comfortable, write them P, sorry, this is XA, sorry. And I think this should be XA, YA, and this should be XB, YB. I think now it is okay. So, this A1 is isothermal with either B1 or B2 or B3. Now, what I do is I repeat the experiment by fixing the state of B at say B2 and hunt out in the state space of A whether there are other states, and you will find that there are other states in the state space of A which are isothermal with this given state B2 of this. First, we did experiment with A fixed at A1. Now, we do experiment with B fixed at B2, and maybe you will find a state A2, A3, A4. You can always say that why should there be a continuous locus? There is no reason, but we generally find that we have considered the state to be continuous. So, in our non-quantized thing, these happen to be continuous locus. Now, the transitivity thing means that A1 and B2 were isothermal. We have discovered that B2 and A4 are also isothermal. So, what is the consequence of this? If I were to take two copies of A, one at A1 and another at A4, they would also be isothermal. Extending this, we will say that any state of A on this will be isothermal with any state of B on this. Extending it further, we would say that take any system which is either A on any one of these states or B on any one of these states. Take some other system which is either A of any one of these states or B of any one of these states. Put them across a diathermic partition. You will discover that they are isothermal. Consequence of Zeroth law. These states, this set of states of in the state space A is known as an isotherm in the state space of A. So, this is an isotherm corresponding to say B2 or B1, and this also is an isotherm. Not just any isotherm, these are known because they belong to the same bin. Any, take any one either from A or B, and take any one either from A or B, you will find them isotherm. These are known as corresponding isotherms. Okay. Now, before we go to temperature, let us go the absolute basic way. what we are going to do now is, let us take a state which is not on these corresponding isotherms in the state space of say A. Repeat the experiment, maybe we will find an isotherm here, and coming back here we will find an isotherm here. So we had a black pair of corresponding isotherms, maybe we had a red pair of corresponding isotherms. Then maybe we do take another thing here, and maybe we will find another set here, maybe blue here, we will have blue here. We can map the state space of A and B and mark out these corresponding isotherms. Remember, what is the advantage of this? If when we have this map, we can do the following. That will be possible only after we do the second law. I want to impress on you that at this stage there is no way we can order these isotherms.
No, but when you do the experiment, naturally it will follow that way, isn't it?
That is after second law. Zeroth law doesn't say so.
Unless, sir, before second
law. Zeroth law doesn't say so.
No, it doesn't say so, but your experiment should always fall in the same line.
It may be from zeroth law, it's okay. Maybe from second law, it's inconsistent. I have done it deliberately for you to ask that question.
Hello, but what I'm saying is your experiment cannot give you different order of lines.
On based on what thermodynamic?
Not based on your experiment.
Based on which thermodynamic?
Your experiment itself. Your experiment itself cannot. Yes, sir. Your experiment itself cannot give you different directions.
No, but suppose I were to see, I have blue, black, green, and red here.
Yeah. If you.
If I were to put blue, black, green, red, you would have asked me why are you putting them in the same order? I have no answer to that just now.
But your experiment gave it. I mean, your experiment cannot give you this order as you have drawn out, is it not?
At this stage, I don't know. I am just saying that.
You need not know the second law, but your experiment will not give you lines like,
but
is it not?
Why are you sure that your experiment doesn't give you so? Zeroth law doesn't say so.
I know, I don't know now, but I know still this will not be so.
Yes, but we will come to that when we come to second law. That's all I am telling you.
Agreed, but.
Okay, at this stage, I am doing this deliberately for people to ask a question so that I can answer that at this stage, we can't do anything more than this. I cannot assert that they have to be in a particular order.
You need not assert, but I am saying naturally it has to happen. Because
I will demonstrate that it has to happen, and I will demonstrate that I was wrong here only after discussing second law.
That's fine.
Because the same thing has happened. In 1 year, I have put them in order, and some students say, sir, why should they be in order? There is no answer. And I put them not in order, and some students say, why are they not in order? There is no answer. At this stage, there is no answer.
The problem is, when we learn from the basics, we should not go for a priori assumptions.
Yes. And I am not
making
any
mistake.
A priori assumption. Yeah.
Without a priori assumptions, you start.
Yes. I will come to that when we come to second law. In zeroth law, I can't say. I will only say that a distinct isotherm here is a distinct isotherm there. The only thing we can argue is, if an isotherm is, corresponding isotherms are black, and if there is a distinct green isotherm here, which does not interact with this black isotherm, that means it is distinct, then on the other set also it has to be distinct. And if a black and green isotherm, they intersect at some point, then we have made some mistake. The same color should be there for both.
Right?
Yes. Only one you do. So, see, a distinct isotherm means if they interact, they have a heat interaction. And if they say that more interaction, more exploration makes the two isotherms meet, then there is something wrong in some experiment which you have done. Now, what is the consequence of this? The consequence of this is the following. Suppose we are given a state, system A and system B. System A in some state say A naught, system B in some state say B naught, and we are asked to predict whether there will be an interaction between them if, when they are allowed to interact across a diathermic partition, heat interaction between them. All that you do is find out whether where A naught lies, which is the isotherm on which it lies. Find out for B naught, which is the isotherm on which it lies. If you find that they lie on the corresponding isotherms, we can say that there will be no heat interaction. If they do not lie on the corresponding isotherms, for example, if A naught is here and B naught is here, we will say there will be no heat interaction because both belong to the black isotherm. But if A naught lies on red isotherm and B naught lies on the green isotherm, we will say yes. If there is a diathermic partition, there will be some heat interaction. At this stage, we can only say there will be some heat interaction. We will not be able to say in which direction it takes place. Okay. Now you will say that, look, it is possible that my system is here, state is here. Then we will say that, look, I have not done experiments in detail. Maybe I should do some more experiment and find out this isotherm. Do some more experiments and find out the corresponding isotherm here and see whether the given state lies on that. Okay. In principle, you can do more detailed experiments and map this out in detail. Now the question arises is, how do we label these isotherms? Here I have given them in colors, but there is our, the sensitivity of the eye is not very good. What I call green, you may call something different, you know, there are various level of color sensitivities with all of us. I can use lines of different thickness, different dot lengths, but it becomes confusing. And hence, we give these things some labels. We have started giving them labels, and these labels are what we call temperature. So, the next definition is temperature is nothing but label on corresponding isotherm. This is the basic definition of temperature. So, here we say that, look, my system A and my system B in the specified states will not interact thermally with each other across a diathermic partition because they belong to the same set of corresponding isotherms, namely black. We will say now in short that, look, the temperature of system A is black, temperature of system B is also black. Since they are at the same temperature, they are isothermal states, belong to the same corresponding isotherms, and hence no heat interaction. Long winded way of things, but this is now, I hope we understand what is meant by temperature and heat interaction. But these labels could be colors, labels could be thickness of lines, design of lines, dotted lines, and they are not useful. If we want to go details, we need labels, why not numbers? Okay. And that brings us to what is known as the experimental science of thermometry and the idea of what is a thermometer. Thermometry is the process by which isotherms in the state space of any given system can be labeled. Usually quantitative. The advantage of quantitative labeling is that we can have precision, hopefully to the extent possible. But there is also a trap here and an assumption here that when we put numbers, the numbers are already in order. So, by default, we are putting temperatures also in order. We are doing it by thermometry, not by any principle of thermodynamics. I think tea time, is tea ready? So we will break.